The broadcast is now starting.
Hello, everyone. Happy Thursday. Happy January. Happy 2022. And welcome to the first episode of the 2022 season of the PixelMill webinar series. And today's offering of breaking out of the box with out of the box SharePoint. Guys, do we have a great story for you today. I am so excited to share this with you. It's going to be a blast today. As always, my name is Michael Wells. I am the senior account manager, partnerships and community manager, and contractually obligated bald guy with a beard for PixelMill. And I'll be around hosting, moderating, making stupid jokes, and other things as well. Guys, we have a great story, like I said, today. This story actually begins 2 years ago. We had a conversation with some of the folks you're going to talk to today about doing some work together. And then the pandemic hit, and we didn't get the chance to really work together for a while. And then about a year later after that, they reached out again and said, hey, we still want to do this. We have some magic we want to create, and we want to make it with you guys. So we said, great, let's do it. And that's the story you're going to hear today, is some of the things we got to do with this group of people. So, I'm really excited to share it with you guys. Let's go on to the agenda for today. We've got some fun things that we want to do. Go through a couple things there. So we're going to start off. I've got some housekeeping and some general introductions that I'm going to do. I'll tell you all about these people that you see to the left and right of me. We're going to talk about how HKS broke down. Broke free and planned for success. I can read today. Pardon me, guys. We're going to show you some before and afters of what the site looked like. We're also going to talk about breaking down some silos. We're going to talk about day in the life of this internet. And then we'll, of course, as always, at the end, have time for some Q&A at the end. So some housekeeping for you guys. If you have any questions that you'd like to throw at our panelists here, throw them on up. There should be a chat tab. There is a questions tab as well. Throw them up in that questions tab. If you're on the desktop app, I believe it's its own pop-out. If you're on the desktop version, there should be a chat bubble with a question mark in it. That's where you throw your questions in there. I'll be keeping track of those as we're going on, and I'll make sure I get those in there. If we don't get to them right in the moment, like I said, we do leave time at the end for some Q&A. If you're more socially minded, please check us out. You can see our stuff there, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, all that fun stuff. We have a lot of great content we're putting out, so please do check us out there. Also, we will have a quick survey at the end for you guys to fill out with a chance to win a little something, but we'll get into that just a little bit later. If you can go to the next slide, please. We'll do some quick introductions here. All right, so let me introduce some people here. First of all, from the PixelMill team, she is a senior manager of marketing and sales. We have Danielle Wells. She'll be leading our session today. And then from HKS, our dear friends here, we've got Neil Schrierden, Emily Disk, and Laura Pike-Seeley. This is our group today. They'll be talking about their journey from getting out of the box with out-of-the-box SharePoint. So Danielle, I'll hand it off to you. Have at it.
Thank you, Michael. Welcome, everyone. Just a little bit about PixelMill here. As Michael said, I'm the Senior Manager of Marketing and Sales. But here at PixelMill, we create beautiful and expertly architected employee experiences through holistic and humanized digital workspaces using Microsoft 365. And I'm going to go ahead and pass it right along to Laura to introduce herself.
Hi, thank you for having us. We are excited to be here today to talk about our intranet journey. I'm Laura Pike-Seeley, and I'm a design librarian and knowledge services professional, currently serving as a knowledge manager at HKS Inc. And in this role, I help to guide the firm's knowledge strategy by championing knowledge building and sharing, information organization and findability, and employee experience within the digital workplace. And my interest in the digital workplace really follows naturally from my background in corporate library services, where effective outreach and communications, information and resource organization, and a constant focus on the user experience are really key drivers of success. And next up on our team, we have Neil Schrierden.
Thanks, Laura. Hi, everyone. I am also a librarian, more with a focus on systems administration and development, digital content organization, taxonomy, and search. And this includes maintenance and development of our intranet, search, permissions, lists and libraries, and system integrations. I'm also the agile product owner for our team, and I am also a longtime viewer of PixelMill webinars, which I've really enjoyed and have learned a lot from. So I'm really pleased to be now participating in one.
We're very happy to have you, Neil.
Emily is next. Thank you.
Thanks, Neil. Well, I am not a librarian by training or any background, but I am a librarian in spirit with these two. I am the Director of Global Knowledge Services at HKS, And what that really means is that I guide the delivery of a digital workplace that helps our employees to connect more effectively, work more effectively, and ultimately problem solve a lot more effectively. Let's touch briefly on the company that we work for. At HKS, we're a global firm of architects, designers, advisors, and makers, and we're devoted to creating places that combine beauty with performance. We strongly believe in the power of design to transform organizations, and this doesn't only apply to the built environment. We also understand that the design of our own resources and tools also has the power to transform our own company. And now, really quickly, I'll hand it back to you, Michael.
Yes, thank you so much, guys. Appreciate the introductions there. So as always, guys, we've got a little poll for you. It's going to pop up on the screen, so please do. We'd love to hear your opinion on it. But the launch right there. So where are you on your internet journey? Currently using a canned solution and want off? Currently using a canned solution and plan to stay? Currently using out-of-the-box SharePoint? Currently using SharePoint with customizations? Or just getting started, I'm not sure which is right for me. Please throw your votes up on up in there. We'll leave this up for a little bit and get some ideas for you guys. This just kind of helps us figure out, you know, where everyone's at. What are you thinking? Where are you? Have you used a canned solution before? What's your internet like? Is it ruining your life? Is it making your day? Is it making your breakfast in the morning? We want to know what your internet's doing for you and how it's affecting your day. I'm gonna give you guys about 10 more seconds. I do see a lot of votes coming in. Thank you so much for everyone who's been playing along. Appreciate that. See a couple more floating in. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. And all right, with that, I am going to close this and I'm going to share the results with you guys. So as you can see, 10% said currently using a canned solution and want off. 20% said currently using out-of-the-box SharePoint. 60% said currently using SharePoint with customizations. 10% said just getting started. I'm not sure which is right for me. And thankfully, 0% of you said currently using a canned solution and plan to stay. Otherwise, this would be the wrong webinar for you. but thank you so much, guys. Great. Really appreciate you guys participating in that. And I will hand it back to our lovely panelists.
Awesome. Thank you. Really insightful. And it's nice to see we have an eclectic group here with us. So I want to start by saying that no matter where you are on your journey, you're going to learn something today. These three people have came to PixelMill having done a ton of work. And it was really exciting to see how dedicated they were to ensuring that their solution met their end user needs. So you're going to walk away with some really good insights, no matter where you are. If you're using Unily, you're using Valo, if you're using out of the box SharePoint, there's something for you. But we're going to start by understanding how you guys got to where you are today. So how did you decide to break out of your intranet in a box, and how was the solution no longer serving you?
The teams at HKS are doing really incredibly complex work that has the potential to change people's lives for the better. Whether we're creating memorable experiences for sports fans, designing for equity in K-12 environments, or even enabling teens living with cancer to better support each other. This level of innovation requires an awareness of industry trends, evidence-based design practices, and the lessons that we as a firm have learned in our 80 plus years of being in business. And because our employees value lifelong learning, we also leave room outside of project work. And that's so our talent can participate in fellowship programs, tap into professional development resources, peer and expert networks, and seek opportunities to give back to our communities. We knew that HKS employees needed a platform where all of those knowledge resources, services, and opportunities were consolidated in one place, a place that contextualized them and made them discoverable, and a place to help our employees make sense of all of these options and understand the best choice for themselves and for their clients. And of course, a place that reflected the firm's refined design sensibility. That place could be our corporate intranet if we could deliver the right functionality. Our existing solution was working against us, so we knew we needed to make a change. Let's talk a little bit about what that challenge looked like at that time. Since 2016, we had grappled with a third-party intranet-in-a-box product that sat on top of our SharePoint environment, but it had lagged far behind Microsoft's enhancements. To compound the problem, the platform had increasingly severe compatibility issues. It was heavily customized, so we had a locked-in homepage layout and major functionality. And it also had some significant quality management problems. It really just wasn't serving us well. It had a small but important footprint, though, and delivered a few key pieces of functionality, including the homepage and our global navigation. But because of its limitations, we were unable to deliver the immersive experience that we were already providing elsewhere within the intranet. And that was a really big problem. With such limited functionality in the homepage and in the navigation, we were missing out on our primary opportunities to engage our users.
Thank you, Emily. I really appreciate that. Now, tackling an intranet migration and redesign involves many stakeholders across the organization. What principles did you use to guide your project to ensure success?
We established a set of guiding principles that we really felt would, at the very least, increase our ability to deliver the right resource for the firm now and into the future. And we really need to deliver something that our coworkers and our own team would not only use, but really actually enjoy. So our intranet is human-centered. It's informed by user interviews, hands-on exercises, iterative prototyping, usability testing, and of course, user acceptance testing. It's guided by input from users across a wide variety of roles, locations, tenures, and areas of expertise. It's intuitive. It prioritizes existing Microsoft and familiar HKS design patterns and uses simple, unambiguous terminology. And importantly, it prioritizes HKS's policy, programs, and resources for sustainability, public interest design, and justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion. Another principle is that our intranet is expert-driven. It supports the priorities of some key stakeholder groups via our information architecture and design, and it removes obstacles for those groups whenever possible. It weaves resources from our subject matter experts throughout the user journey, and it relies on the right partners like PixelMill and Sue Hanley for guidance in areas of high complexity or high dependence on Microsoft's roadmap. And finally, our intranet is agile and it handles change with grace. It anticipates areas of change that could be, you know, perhaps the firm's requirements or our own knowledge program priorities. And it leverages a modern information architecture and taxonomies to create that agility. And it also tries to anticipate the future direction of Microsoft 365 and align with a broader vision of a holistic digital workspace.
Thank you, Emily. And Microsoft definitely keeps us on our toes.
It certainly does.
Yes. Well, Laura, this next question is for you. What were your priorities for the new solution?
Yeah, you know, we had specific priorities for the employee experience, knowledge resources, and the technical aspects of the project. The employee experience was a key focus. We wanted to enable action and deliver insights in a way that's personalized, relevant, and contextualized. We prioritized creating a cohesive user experience and more intuitive ways for employees to understand and navigate throughout the resources. And we wanted to provide users with more control within commonly used features and improve workflows by centralizing functionality and information. Now, in terms of knowledge resources, we wanted to highlight and celebrate the firm's most valuable asset, and that's the knowledge of our employees. We aim to deliver targeted content to different user groups, and we wanted to move from simply enabling tasks to supporting work in different contexts and better connecting users to knowledge resources. Now, in terms of the technical solution, we wanted to really leverage our existing Microsoft products as much as possible and seek improvements to the existing configuration. For key functionality that wasn't available in our existing products, we wanted to implement lightweight third-party solutions or tightly scoped customizations. And finally, we needed to create a solution that our small internal team could maintain going forward.
Excellent. Now, you had to establish some clear requirements for the work. How did you go about that?
Yes, we did. And we had a fairly pragmatic approach to eliciting requirements. Our team's experience running the firm's knowledge management program, which does include the intranet, had already given us the opportunity to document many of our requirements and gather notes during previous engagements. When we approached this effort, we took the opportunity to build on those insights with a few focused discovery exercises. We accomplished this by looking at what the users told us via interviews, what the users generated with us via card sort exercises, brainstorming, and interaction with low fidelity prototypes. What the data told us, our intranet-in-a-box and SharePoint analytics helped us to identify highly used features and content. What the experts told us through engaging Sue Handley and, of course, PixelMill to provide specific recommendations and best practices. And then finally, what our own experience told us from our previous projects, our knowledge management communities of practice, and a bit of intuition. And through that discovery work, we arrived at a specific scope: homepage replatform and redesign, global navigation replatform and redesign, apps and bookmarks tool, unified and streamlined search experience, and a custom web part with improved query and display control. And those last three pieces of functionality weren't possible with our existing out-of-the-box options. So we went through an exercise to determine whether we would buy or build. We assessed promising third-party options, but didn't find any combination that met all of our basic requirements. So we knew we needed to build some custom functionality, and that's when we turned to the PixelMill team.
Thank you, Laura. And we will be providing a resource here at the end of the session. And one of those resources is a handy little infographic that we put together that helps you walk through and determine whether you should go out of the box, whether you need a custom solution, or you need a third-party solution. So stay tuned. We'll make sure we get that in front of you as well. All right. So next question is for you, Emily. One of the major initiatives that you guys took on first when migrating from your canned solution was redesigning your homepage. And you were able to do much of this out of the box. Can you share your process in determining what should live on that valuable real estate?
Absolutely. So fortunately, we already had a close working relationship with the internal communications team. And unfortunately, knew all too well that the existing homepage was really difficult for them to update, which often led to a lot of stale above the fold content. So we already had ample documentation around the existing issues, so we were able to spend time discussing what the optimal future design and functionality might be. We started by understanding their recently updated content strategy and how the homepage should operate in concert with all of their other communications tools and channels. Once we understood the scope of that content, we recommended an information hierarchy that reflected their communication priorities. We actually used an extremely low fidelity sticky note style prototype. You're seeing part of it here on the screen, to support that conversation. Once we had alignment on the hierarchy of information, we then explored a lot of different options, including what we could do to support communications for rapidly changing health and safety resources. You know, don't forget, our work was taking place, you know, in the early days of the pandemic, and they had some specific communication priorities there. They needed to communicate in that domain without compromising space for other above the fold messaging needs. We wanted to bring in content from the firm's website and social media platforms, really to help our own employees stay in tune with how the firm was presenting itself at any point in time. We needed to match the requirements of each type of content to sets of SharePoint web parts that we knew would also be really easy for that team to use. And we were looking at opportunities to release some of the publishing pressure on that really small team by surfacing knowledge and technical content from other internal content owners. So working iteratively with that team allowed us to quickly prototype a few different options and arrive at this vibrant and engaging homepage that was also really easy for them to manage. And the proof is in the daily experience. Now our users see new content multiple times a week. They can more easily connect to HKS news and events, understand the multitude of resources that we have for them, and explore thought leadership and all sorts of technical resource updates. And as a quick note, as we look at these snapshots of screens really rapidly, don't worry, we'll be showing them in greater detail in a demo later in the presentation.
Wonderful. Thank you, Emily. So you also took this opportunity to revamp your intranet navigation. Can you tell me a little bit about how you guys went through that process?
Yeah, our existing navigation structure had been in place for about 10 years, and user feedback indicated that while it was familiar, it definitely wasn't working. The navigation reflected the company's org structure, which created really significant barriers for users who didn't know which department was responsible for the particular piece of information they were seeking. We knew it would be important to rework the navigation based on common information and knowledge-seeking scenarios. We needed to understand and design for the different contexts of work and look for places like the top navigation to reinforce those rhythms. And we also needed to develop a global navigation that worked for users in all roles across the globe. This was not an insignificant feat. So to do that, we knew it was important to engage a diverse group of employees, seeking individuals from different roles, departments, and offices, as well as participants with anywhere from 1 month to 20 years of employment with the firm, so that we could understand their different ways of thinking about the company, the resources, and their work at hand. We used a few different techniques with our users. We relied on card sorting to understand common terminologies and mental models. The broad user group gave us a lot of different perspectives. They actually arrived at significantly different structures, which was quite a surprise, and pretty fun to see the different frameworks that everyone had. The major challenge for our team was to examine the output of those exercises for patterns and seek to align the common areas. There were actually surprisingly few. And we were also looking to flag areas that may represent latent needs that we could explore. And speaking of exploration, we did a lot via prototypes, many, many prototypes. A lot of the prototypes could be pretty quickly discarded, but we ultimately wrestled them down to one really high potential model, and we also had a plan B. So we moved the most promising model forward into scenario-based usability testing. And this was really where the rubber met the road. It quickly validated the most sound navigational areas. Our test participants were really generous with their insight, especially when they've provided explanations at the end of each session. And those provided us with some of the best points of improvement. So we analyzed the test results, incorporated a lot of the user insights, and updated our prototype. We went through testing again with a completely different, yet still diverse group of users. And we were really pleased we got consistently improved test results. So from there, we consulted with a few key stakeholders for some tiebreaker decisions, and we had it, the brand new navigation. We did learn a lot while we were going through this process, and I wanted to make a specific point. The most useful tip I could give is to record the usability testing sessions so that your user actions can later be translated into a spreadsheet format and assessed against your success criteria. If you're recording the sessions, it also allows you to be a lot more present and focused in the moment in those sessions. So you're able to use the recordings of the sessions and just translate step by step into spreadsheets. And the pass-fail patterns that you'll see there, you can see a few of them on screen here, those are going to highlight your areas for further refinement. And an additional note, we did always receive consent to record the session, and we assured every participant that the recording was only going to be used by our team for that specific testing purpose. So let's move on and actually look at the before and after of the navigation. And before is on the left, very reflective of the org structure. The new design is on the right, so you can see that our users are now enjoying a frictionless experience that's designed around their daily needs, not the company's ever-changing org structure.
Wonderful. Thank you, Emily. From a technical standpoint, your legacy canned intranet solution was definitely holding you guys back, mostly because you lacked control over several elements. And search was undoubtedly one of those significant pain points. Neil, can you tell us about how your new search improves your employee experience?
Yes, I'm real happy with our new search experience. So it's fun to share this. By the time we started working with you all, we had a very specific set of technical requirements, but without real clarity on how to make this work or look. We really benefited from PixelMill's capabilities in UI and UX design and Microsoft patterns and practices. And they delivered this for us, web parts that really exceeded our expectations. What you see here is kind of a spreadsheet of all the, how kind of granularly we had laid out our requirements. But our search definitely needed improvement. The canned internet solution was really preventing us from making the changes we wanted, first of all. But aside from that, we had very clunky results and refinement. We had done a lot of work cataloging content, but didn't really have search that was utilizing that effectively. And since we knew we wanted improved custom refinement, this has so far ruled out of the box Microsoft search for us. So we had started using the PMP modern search web parts a little bit, but not as a replacement of our main search center. we were limited in our ability to customize the templates to the degree that we wanted. So our new search now consolidates into one search center, four verticals, each with a set of filter options so we can start utilizing those better. A lot of those real specific ones are in that knowledge libraries vertical there, but from the result items, we removed a lot of visual clutter like URL strings. We added more user-friendly cues like the name of the site where the content lives, preview image, and added metadata like authors and rights. And using these PMP modern search web parts allows us to also use the results web part of that group of web parts as a replacement of the out-of-the-box highlighted content web part with control over elements such as see all and author, which you'll see that actually more in action during the upcoming demo of our Insight Center.
Now, your old solution did have some personalized functionality that critically impacted your users. How did you address this with your new solution?
Well, we knew from usage analytics and user feedback that the third-party app drawer that we had was a really must-have functionality. Our users relied on it to access the tools we use to get work done. But we also knew that it was slow to load and had an unreasonably high learning curve to navigate and select favorites. It was very clunky overall to use. And due to compatibility issues, it was really, at this point, was only available on our homepage as well. So we wanted to create a custom applications feature that would retain the existing functionality, but reduce the load time, simplify the interface, and add a search functionality to it, and leverage familiar design patterns to make usage of it all more intuitive. PixelMill was able to deliver this for us in a very future-proofed way following Microsoft patterns and practices. On PixelMill's recommendation, we were also able to introduce a complimentary bookmarks feature that we didn't have at all before to allow our users to save and organize links from inside and outside the intranet. So the new solution now has applications and bookmarks that work together and in partnership with a global navigation. So our users are always just a click away from their most used resources. These two features persist across the intranet now, and were designed specifically to complement the new Microsoft app bar that we're also rolling out.
Wonderful. Thank you, Neil. We talk a lot about how information can really get siloed into whether it's by department or specific sites. And I know that was really important to your team as knowledge management experts. As the global knowledge team, your goal is to get the right information to the right team members at the right time. And your new Insight Center does that, and nearly with all out-of-the-box SharePoint. So Laura, I would love to see that in action. There we go.
It's really about improving the employee experience by centering employee knowledge, making it easy to find what they need, and giving them opportunities to grow as thought leaders. So the Insight Center is our team's signature knowledge product, and it's designed to serve as a hub for topical exploration and learning. So as opposed to search, the Insight Center is all about browsing. Any knowledge resource that gets pulled into our knowledge ecosystem, whether that's peer-reviewed articles, event recordings, news articles, or internally authored reports, are discoverable within the Insight Center. The landing page of the Insight Center surfaces the newest materials by content type, such as recordings, documents, blog posts, etc. We allow people to access knowledge resources by practice area, which is commonly where they think to go. But in order to bust silos, we also encourage people to browse by four practice agnostic megatopics, which do map onto our research team's areas of focus. For example, when we click on climate and carbon, we see a list of important firm resources, design tools, knowledge guides, blog posts, and more. The foundational concepts here are really contextualization and modularity. Any materials that get added to our knowledge ecosystem that are tagged with terms related to sustainable design automatically appear on this page. Now, if one of those items is tagged with terms relating to one of our other mega topics like digital and material technology, it's going to appear on that page as well. To pull in many of these materials, we relied on the out-of-the-box SharePoint news web part and also the highlighted content web part. However, the view of that highlighted content web part currently can only be configured in limited ways. As some of you probably know, the out-of-the-box web part, for example, displays the name of the person who uploaded the document. And that meant that the name was very often someone from within our team, and that wasn't helpful information to display. It could even be misleading. When we engaged PixelMill, we asked for a customizable, highly configurable web part that could pull in documents and pages according to specific criteria. We are now able to display the exact information we want in those web parts, any fields that we've identified. They also gave us a solution that lets us customize the see all link, lets us send users to any URL that we designate. And ultimately, this has given us a level of control we really needed to fulfill our vision of a knowledge-centric, user-friendly, SharePoint-driven digital workplace. So far, we've talked about a lot of separate features. Let's explore how these different pieces work together to provide a seamless experience for our employee, Hannah.
Hannah is a busy marketing manager who supports pursuits in many different practice areas. She likes to stay in the know about everything HKS across all regions and practices. When Hannah sits down in her home office, the first thing she does is visit the source homepage to see if there are important internal announcements or new events on the horizon. She likes that the homepage also surfaces content that's being shared externally. Hannah appreciates user-friendly technologies that she can customize to her needs and purposes, and that's just as true when she's at work. When she needs to check the marketing reports for a mid-morning meeting, she opens up My Apps and finds it easily in the favorites list she built for herself. She's also able to see the latest business development resources through a link she saved to My Bookmarks. Hannah loves that these links persist across the source and across browsers, so they're easy for her to access during the workday. After lunch, Hannah meets with a newly onboarded member of her team, Enrique. Hannah quickly points him to the source top nav, and specifically the quick links vertical. Here, links to very common tasks are collected, making it easy to fill out timesheets, arrange for travel, connect to printers, and more. Overall, Enrique likes that the top nav helps him to find things quickly and to be able to see at a glance the different work groups and functions within the organization. Still, it's a lot to take in. Hannah reminds Enrique that you don't have to know where everything is. You just have to be able to run an effective search. And the Source Search Center helps employees to do just that. She demonstrates how she uses the Source Search, pulling up a list of resort portfolios for her afternoon meeting with the hospitality practice. She also shows Enrique the Insight Center, which helps her to find knowledge resources by topic and understand the HKS point of view on a number of issues. Enrique browses the list of knowledge guides. He knew that HKS had experts on workplace experience and the future of work, but being able to see all of the presentations, recordings, and reports in one place helps him to contextualize that expertise. At the end of the day, Hannah and Enrique appreciate that the intranet is keeping them in the know, reflecting the best of the organization's culture, and connecting them to the resources they need to make effective decisions and grow as professionals.
Thank you very much. And we're coming back loud and clear. All right.
We are.
Let's talk a little bit about lessons learned. You guys, again, I said at the beginning of the session, you came to us having done a lot of extensive work. And I think that's the biggest takeaway here is that you have a solution that works well because you took the time to listen to your users. And that empathetic design is key to any success. So what is the most important lesson you learned when defining your intranet requirements?
Well, in a nutshell, for us, it was sticking to developing the requirements themselves and letting the experts devise the solution. Even in the process of doing it, you can become aware that it's very easy to lose sight of that boundary. But when you do stick to just developing requirements, you get kind of the best results for everyone involved. So we spent time developing really clear requirements and putting together supporting documentation for it. Then we lean on PixelMill experts, let them bring their knowledge of best practices, UI, UX design, Microsoft intelligence. And as a result, we were really surprised and delighted with their recommendations and approach.
Now, what was the most surprising thing that came out of your discovery, Emily?
Oh, yeah. I love speaking to this one because it was definitely a surprise that we appreciated. It was how astonishingly gracious our users were when asked to lend their time and insight to this project. Not a single person declined. And I think that's amazing. And we didn't just invite our trusted friends. We wanted different perspectives. We wanted people we don't frequently connect with, and absolutely wanted to include people who are highly skeptical of efforts like this. And then beyond that, we were actually really surprised by how much those users enjoyed the discovery conversations and the hands-on exercises and even the testing. We actually had a few people do multiple sessions because they wanted to approach the challenge from a few different angles. So we definitely had some overachievers. And I do think it's worth noting that a lot of credit goes to Laura, Neil, and Victoria, members of our team. They definitely have a reputation for being trustworthy partners with a genuine intent to improve the firm's resources. That goes a really long way with our users and where they're willing to invest their time.
Wonderful, Emily. Thank you. I think that's so key too. I think sometimes people are afraid. I don't want to waste someone's time, or people won't take the time to do it. And I think people are pleasantly surprised to see how willing people and how much people's impact on the solution impacts their adoption of the solution as well. When they Absolutely. Feel like personal ownership with it. And I love that you guys did extend and do your best to ensure that you got a really good sampling from your users. Now you obviously have done a fantastic job, but if hindsight's 2020, so if you could go back and do anything differently, what would you change?
We've never had access to really robust usage analytics. And what we did have was actually made a lot more difficult because we were operating with a dual CMS scenario. So we had to really kind of cobble together the data points that we were seeking. And we ultimately had to rely a lot more heavily on user interviews, but we really would have benefited from the ability to mine the data a lot more for relevant patterns in user behaviors.
That totally makes sense. Absolutely. Well, we have some listeners here who are embarking on a similar journey. So what advice do you have for them?
Well, by this point in the presentation, I don't think this is going to come as a surprise, but it's possible to have really meaningful user engagement on a project like this, regardless of the size of your team, your tools and resources, or your prior experience. If you spend your time identifying really just what you need to know, and then figuring out the exercises that will help you elicit those answers, that is the important piece. And if you end up just talking to only one person, that is going to be an improvement. And the only thing that's really out of your control is actually just whether the users will be willing to talk to you. So start working on that one early. To prove this point, let's actually talk about ourselves. We're a four-person team. We had multiple other projects in flight. This was actually a project we took on in addition to all of the rest of our daily work. We also don't have sophisticated tools, as you may have noticed from some of what we showed on these slides. We did our discovery and prototyping using the free version of Miro, PowerPoint, Excel, and Zoom. And that was really it. In the final stages, we just mocked up the functionality directly in SharePoint. And for the custom solution, we relied on the PixelMill team's resources and ingenuity when we were really iterating through the custom solutions. And at the core of this, we were just really relentlessly curious about how our users think, how our users work, and what barriers they were encountering. And slowly, just conversation by conversation, exercise by exercise, the solution began to emerge. And our users are telling us that it's a really good one. So to all of the listeners, just don't skip that part.
Have to agree. Well, you, as you said, your users are pretty happy. What would you say your biggest win with your redesign has been?
We've got an interesting story here, actually. It's a little bit of an unexpected one. During the project, we experienced a significant organizational shift that happened to a really, really important stakeholder group, our internal communications team. 3 days before the firm-wide reveal of the intranet updates, our internal comms team shifted into a completely new department with completely new leadership. This could have caused really serious problems for our launch plan and just been incredibly stressful. Not only does that internal comms team curate the homepage, their new leadership hadn't been part of developing any of the solution that we were about to roll out. But because of the user-centered design process and all of the artifacts of our work, we actually had a number of stakeholders who were able to speak to the value of and the rationale behind our solution, because we had done the work directly with these users, we had built trust, and they were really amazing advocates for our solution. Because of the principles that guided this work, we were able to demonstrate to the new leadership that this work was also agile by design and could support the new leader's priorities if they differed. So it ended up being the start of a really, really great new working relationship, and we were able to move forward with the launch as planned, even though it was just days away. And it actually helped introduce that organizational change to the firm at the same time. It was a really neat opportunity.
Wow. Goes to show how important all that work you did up front. It's a really, really amazing story. I know we're getting close to our time here, so I want to make sure everyone gets an opportunity to download that resource that I was talking about. It's got a few links in there from some resources that HKS used in their discovery process. And then that a link to our blog post all about how to make that decision about whether you need an app you can use out of the box, whether you need a custom solution, or if a third party might be the right fit. So you'll see that pop up there, and you can download that. And I'm going to roll right into a big thank you to everyone here. Laura, Neil, Emily, I can't thank you enough for your time. I think you guys have shared some really amazing insights, and I truly appreciate that. And thank you to everyone who's listening as well. Emily, I know you have some thanks to give as well, so I'll pass that to you.
Thanks so much. First, I'd like to thank the HKS employees who gave so generously of their time to guide our work, and give a special thanks to Victoria for voicing our user, Hannah. And a really big thank you to the PixelMill team. So, you know, specifically Michael, Carolyn, Liv, Kunal, Amy, and Corey, thank you for guiding us through this. Your work really transforms the daily experience of hundreds of HKSers around the globe, and we are really proud of what we created together. So thank you so much. And Michael, I'm going to hand it to you now.
Yes, you are. Thank you so much, everybody. So as always, we have our survey that we like to do. We like to just get some feedback. We're big proponents of we're only going to learn by hearing what's going on. So please, fill that survey out. Let us know what you're thinking about the webinar series, how you're feeling about everything, and all that. So there is that QR code, or you can see the link on the screen as well. We'll leave that up for just a bit for you guys to get that going. Again, enter that do that survey, and you're entered to win a $50 Amazon gift card. It's a nice thing to have, as always, right? So with that, we're also going to do our drawing from our last session, which was our November-December session. I've got my handy-dandy bucket full of names right here. Let me go ahead and pull them out here live on air with you guys. And our lucky winner from last session is William Van Streen. I hope I pronounced that last name correctly. If I didn't, I apologize, because I'm the worst at names. William Van Streen, congratulations for winning our contest last time. I will be reaching out after the session to get that set up with you. So congratulations for that. This is can stay up for just a couple more seconds. Like I said, we've got that QR code. We've got the link right there. Again, fill out that survey, enter yourself to win, and enter yourself for a chance to win a $50 Amazon gift card. And yeah, I think that's it for that one. Danielle, back to you. Back to you, still to me for Q&A. That's right. I know what's coming up next, guys. All right. So there were a lot of questions that came in during the session, and you guys were doing such a great job. I did not want to interrupt. So let me just pull those up there real quick. A few questions that came in here. All right. This is from our buddy Leo. I'm interested in how you are personalizing the employee experience. What things do you personalize? Are those based on user preferences, or are they role/department driven?
We are not actually delivering significant personalization at this point, although we designed all of the components, especially the custom pieces that we worked with PixelMill on, to support the personalization. What we're actually looking at organizationally right now is how we go about defining different audiences in our user base, but not looking at that in isolation to only our intranet, but looking at how that applies much more broadly to the user experience of the audiences that we're defining, and how they not only have a customized experience with the intranet, but in their default access with specific permissions in different tools, proprietary and third party, and reporting dashboard news and information. But we're taking that really seriously. And so it's a special effort of ours right now, just making sure that we don't look only at our intranet, but do it really holistically. You know, if we're talking about a digital workplace, let's actually give them a well-orchestrated, cohesive digital workplace.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Emily, for that. Appreciate that. All right. Our next question comes in, comes in from our friend Lori. Let's see. Did you consider integrating and or using Teams spaces in combination with SharePoint online sites? Oh, and the first part of this is just asking, is this SharePoint online? And then did you consider integrating slash using Teams spaces in combination with SharePoint online sites?
I can answer that one. Neil, holler if you'd like to add anything. Yes, we are using SharePoint online. And we are also using Teams, but it is still in its early stages. And we're kind of prototyping and piloting a few different approaches and seeing where it falls into our mix of tools right now. As a professional services firm, we have some unique constraints around information retention. And so we're actually building a larger plan on how Teams is going to be governed. But yes, we are absolutely thinking of the role that Teams plays along with the intranet and our other Microsoft products.
Excellent.
I can add just kind of technical points on the sort of, so first of all, with permissions, I just wanted to kind of clarify that, like Emily said, we have 8 Active Directory permissions that are very specific to SharePoint that we use. We nest them inside SharePoint groups. And so now that we're moving away from this internet in the box that was sitting on top of the old approach of one site collection with a ton of different subsites, and now we're moving into where we got all these top level sites, we're still sort of using those AD permission groups in the new top level sites. But as Emily was describing, we have in mind doing audience targeting and that, and we're planning for that. But because we had those kind of AD groups aren't really well defined that help us kind of, as Emily said better than I will, as far as like span, you know, they apply better to groups and aren't just real specific to the intranet. They kind of are better defined. We need to define this better before we can move on to that. And then in terms of Teams, I was going to say that the intranet is very specifically scoped to content not in Teams. Now we have those 4 verticals, one of which is in search as a My Documents vertical. And in that vertical, the scope for that does include users' Teams content. But in the all source, which is what we call our intranet, that one we have Teams content not included, because it's, you know, we spend a lot of time with the content that's in the source that we very much would muddy the waters with the way that, because of the way that we use Teams, we keep that content out of it. I just wanted to add those 2 thoughts.
Yeah, that's a really good distinction, Neil, because what we see, and I don't know how significantly different HKS use of Teams is than a different orgs, but our teams of people are using Microsoft Teams in a really quick and dirty, small group, iterative way. And the information that is shared within a particular Microsoft team is not necessarily authoritative or a final vetted resource. And in contrast with that, we take very seriously how important the resources on the intranet are, and that they need to be not only quickly discoverable, but trustworthy. And so we're careful to separate out the information so we don't have users turning to our intranet, seeking authoritative information, but receiving commingled result sets that could include, you know, someone's scratch pad of ideas and potentially mislead someone about what they're looking for.
And I'd say in that way, Teams is working really well for us. Like that's a good that's a good use for Teams. Somewhere I saw, maybe there's a question somewhere I noticed it's about that Viva Connections, connect, like putting team, this ability to embed your kind of homepage into Teams. I have tested in a dev tenant we have, and we've looked at that, but we're not doing that yet. And it's just not something we're doing. Can't remember where I saw that. I feel like there was a question about that.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are trying to figure out what is Viva, first of all, and how do we incorporate it? And here at PixelMill, we really see Viva as the fruition of the promise that Microsoft's been telling us for a long time, that all of these components are going to work in concert together. So we are really excited about the future of that. And our co-founder Eric's been saying for years, Teams will be the, I think he calls it the single pane of glass into your digital workspace. And we see that. And I think this is the first view of that promise that we are going to be surfacing our intranet in Teams and helping eliminate some of that context switching that is really taking a lot of productivity away from our team members. So, you know, and by building the way you guys have been building, which is out of the box, and following when you aren't building out of the box and you're customizing, you're following the best patterns and practices from Microsoft, you're going to be able to utilize these new innovations. Things are going to work better together as we start to connect the pieces with things like Viva. So I'm really excited to see where you guys take Viva and utilize those tools to help your team throughout their workday. And like you were saying, Emily, as you guys define those user groups and you're thinking about them beyond just the intranet, that really plays into Viva as well. Because if you're thinking about what resources they might need beyond just consuming content in the intranet, I think that's really key. So you guys are doing some amazing forward-thinking work there in thinking about it from a holistic perspective.
Definitely, definitely. So I know we've only got a few minutes left. I do have a couple questions I want to sneak in here, so I want to get those in. Next question is from our friend Bibu. How much of this was customized over the out-of-the-box SharePoint? What was the duration for this project? So a two-parter there.
The pieces of customization, I really wish we had a slide for this.
I know.
But it was customization to the search, the My Apps and Bookmarks functionality. If everyone remembers, it's those two little buttons in the upper left-hand corner of the SharePoint screens that just follow you as long as you're in our SharePoint environment. And then there were the third piece of customization was the web part, just adding more control over the display that we have in the content query web parts. The rest of it, we were really just taking advantage of as much configuration and fine-tuning as we could deliver, and then making sure that, you know, we were just hitting all the marks in terms of information hierarchy, design, and content. That was all just done with straight out of the box SharePoint. There was a second half to the question, wasn't there?
What was the duration of the project? Yeah,
or duration?
We actually, it was off and on due to the pandemic. We started the discovery during the course of our work. I'll be honest, we started to gather some of the info that informed this work in 2016, like day one of working with the third-party intranet in a box. First time we touched it, we knew it was not ultimately going to be the solution for us. So we used a lot of the work that we did in the intervening time to gather our thoughts and observations about what we were seeing and hearing from users and experts. But we began in earnest with this effort, actually, I guess it's about 3 years ago, but we had a fairly quick burn turnaround for the work. I couldn't say off the top of my head. Michael, you may recall that it was perhaps 6 months.
Yeah, that's what my gut was saying too. Yeah. 6 months with us, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that was the actual, you know, hands-on engagement with PixelMill doing the work, and not inclusive of all of the discovery activity that we had done with our users.
Absolutely. So I know we're right at time. I want to get this last question in, and then we'll let everybody get on with your day. Last question is, how much energy, this is from our friend Lynn, how much energy does your team have to spend on curation? Our org's biggest challenge is keeping track of the new developments and silos that we want everyone to be aware of. I'm always boggled by how a team can focus access to their entire intranet into a single hub page.
That's an amazing question. And Laura probably has the best answer, but I think it's interesting that the question included, how much energy do we have to put towards that? The answer is boundless.
Yeah.
But that's the primary focus of our day-to-day roles. Laura, do you want to expand on an answer?
I would say working with subject matter experts and building those relationships with other people who can help to identify and curate the content that is available so that we become more responsive in terms of the strategy, making sure things get published and tagged the way they need to be, which for us involves a lot of thinking about taxonomy and thinking about how we describe our resources. But yes, and with architecture and the number of practices we engage with, I mean, it is really a boundless amount of content and information. So there is effort to figure out what's going to speak best to our employees, what's answering questions that our clients are asking, our teams are asking, leadership is asking, and really focusing our efforts there. So we could go in 1,000 directions, and we try not to, because there's a small team, but really building those relationships and sticking to our priorities helps.
Excellent. Thank you, Laura, for that. All right, guys, so that is our time. We've got a couple minutes over. Thank you so much, everyone, for sticking with us throughout this. Big, big thank you to Laura, Neil, Emily. Thank you so much for joining us today. Thank you, Danielle, for leading the charge on this. This has been a truly wonderful session. We've been so excited about this since we announced it at the end of last year that I'm so happy we finally got to share it with you guys. We'll be here every last Thursday of the month with our webinar series. We'll be announcing our next webinar here shortly. Just fine-tuning the last few details of that, and then we'll have that information out to you guys. So everyone, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it. Have a great rest of your Thursday. Have a great rest of your weekend, a great rest of your January, and we will see you all down the road. Take it easy, everybody.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.